Okay, stage show yours, Brad.
Thank you. I was told I had to wear the cat ears. I think she was trying to kid me.
Yeah.
I'm not wearing them. So hi, my name is Brad Urani. I work for Procore in Santa Barbara, California. This is my first time in Taiwan, and I've just had the experience of a lifetime. This place is amazing. I absolutely love it. This is us eating beef noodles last night, which is like the most delicious thing I've ever had. I don't know how you all make that, but it's absolutely phenomenal. I think I drank all the broth at the end. It was so good. So thank you. Thank you for the wonderful time and for the conference organizers for having this event and for everyone who's been so great to me while I've been here in this country. So this is a talk about huge web apps, giant web apps. Web apps with over a million lines of code. And it's about the challenges. And spoiler alert, it turns out that huge web apps, a lot of the tough part is about restraint, keeping things simple, and focusing on what's important. It's not necessarily about really complex technical architectures and things like that. It's more about not doing that. In fact, I'm going to probably talk more about what you shouldn't do than what you should. So first of all, an app that was not so huge. Between 2010 and 2012, I worked at this company, RunningShoes.com, which was an online retailer that sold shoes. And we were a group of four developers. And this app was about 4 or 5 years old. It had probably 20,000 to 30,000 lines of code. And at the time, I thought that was pretty big. Turns out I was wrong. That's actually small to medium size. It's not really the lines of code that makes it small or big. What made it small was basically that all of us on the team, all four of us, really understood how it worked. We all sat next to each other. Any one of us at any time could work on any part of the app. I mean, not everyone knew every line of code, but for the most part, everyone understood how it worked. And because we were a small little team, we established patterns. You know, we had sort of an MVC architecture, but we had our own layers of an adapter layer and a service layer and a data access layer. It was kind of a class design of our own, and everyone knew it, and everyone followed it. And it wasn't that hard because, like I said, this was not that huge of an app. So after that, I worked for a startup called Upside. We made financial planning software, and it looked kind of like this. We sold it to financial firms. You could put your logo up in the top, and it was to help people save for retirement and things like that. And that was a tiny app. There were four of us. We built it in a year and a half. It was a startup. The company only had 10 people in it. But a funny thing happened. We got acquired by a huge company. Our startup got bought by a giant corporation that makes financial software. If you don't know financial software, you've probably never heard of them, but we got acquired by a company with about 2,000 employees and a giant web app, a huge web app that looked like this. It had over a million lines of code in it. It was 16 years old. It was written in Java. The team was split. I think there were 100 or 200 developers between the US and India. So I was in a different atmosphere here. I'm a startup guy mostly, and I found myself working for this company on this giant web app, which was a new experience and a new challenge. And the interesting thing is that I learned something when I started working for this company. The CTO told me that they released their software twice a year, once every 6 months. And I said, why? Why don't you release more often? Why don't you release every month? And they said, well, the customers don't like it, because every time we change something, the customers complain. It's the who moved my cheese syndrome, you know, because we move things around. And that struck me as very, very strange. And I wondered why, you know, this is waterfall, obviously. This is the epitome of waterfall. And I wondered why they got stuck there. And he even told me, actually, we're probably going to change pretty soon. We're only going to do once a year. And that didn't seem right to me. Scared customers, right? And every change had to go through a lot of different people had to approve it. They had application architects who approved every change. They had a DBA who approved every change to the database schema, to every table, and this whole host of product managers and other people. And by the time it got down to the devs who were actually doing the coding, they were pretty much just taking orders. What were they doing wrong? I don't really know because they left. There's no way I was going to stay at that company. So I moved to another company called Procore in California, where I live now, and this is where I work now, and we make software for the construction management industry. We make software for people who build buildings. So if you're going to build a stadium, a skyscraper, you know, a train station, you use our software, and it's a huge suite of enterprise software that does everything you need to do a project like this. And this is also big software. We are over a million lines of code. It's 13 years old, and it's Ruby on Rails from the very early days. We started on Ruby on Rails on version 0.9. So we're now up to Rails 4, of course. We've kept up with the upgrades, some of them painful. We're going to be on Rails 5 very soon. We're in beautiful, sunny Santa Barbara, California. But you can see here that there's some similarities in these two companies, right? The difference is we release our software 2 or 3 times a day. Actually, sometimes more, probably more like 4 or 5 times a day. New versions are going out constantly. I've been there about 1.5 years, and there's never been a day where we didn't ship new code. So we have some things in common here. These are both sort of enterprise software companies, right? Not that enterprise, but enterprise is in, these are companies with both of these companies, the one that did financial software, the one that does construction software, they both have thousands of features. So these are not your do one thing well type of companies, like Instagram, Twitter, right? They basically do one thing well. This is not about that. This is software with thousands of features. It's private software, B2B, right? They both have big support teams. They're both very expensive solutions, very large web apps with over 1 million lines of code, but with some huge differences, right? In the way the process is done and the way releases are done. So, and a lot of them even had similar features, intense user management. The software, both of these companies had software that had like really, really demanding demands about permissions and about security and about which users are allowed to do what. They both had complete document management solutions, financial things. They were both integrating with third-party accounting systems and ERPs, both heavy on like reports and data visualizations. They're both mobile companies as well as companies. So these companies, despite the completely different culture and the completely different process, do have a lot in common in what they're actually building. And the technical challenges are similar too. These are both companies that rely heavily on relational databases. Both of them had databases with hundreds of tables. I think ours is like 600 or 700 tables in our database right now. You know, it's the kind of thing where like, here's your web page, here's a button, and to decide whether this button should be enabled or not, you have to do a join across like 6 different tables, checking permissions and things like that. So it's heavily relational, a lot of joins. Data integrity is, of course, a big deal. And so we've got similarities, approximately 80 to 100 coders on each one. Big apps, but big differences. One company releases every 6 months. One company releases 4 to 5 times a day. One company takes like 6 to 9 months to decide what to build. At Procore, if you say, Brad, the customer asks for X, I can usually deliver X the next day. On a huge app with 1 million lines of code, we knock out features in 1 day. And the customers are different. On one side, we had customers who fear change, and on one side, we had customers who love change. So what is it? What's the difference? Why are these companies so different despite so many similarities? Was it Ruby versus Java? Well, there are some differences here, right? Guess what? That's not it. It wasn't that. Was it 2 different types of customers? One services construction, one is about personal finance. No, that wasn't it either, in fact, because actually the world of finance has been computerized long before construction. If anything, you expect it to be the opposite. In fact, you'd be surprised at how much of the world of construction is still done by emailing around Excel sheets and even fax machines. So you would expect the opposite. So no, it wasn't the difference in customers. It turns out there were differences in process and differences in the way they approach technical problems. So I'm going to start with the process, and I'm going to say the one thing, you know, there's always a risk, you know, always be wary. When anyone ever tells you like, oh, there's one thing, right? Always be wary, but I'm gonna go ahead and take that risk. The big difference for me was that at the company that was agile, that ships every day, they really, really encourage autonomy. Autonomy and ownership at the team and individual level. It's a company that ships every day, trusts its employees to implement the right decision with as few other people involved as possible. And it's mainly autonomy at the team level. So our organization has, I think, 120 people in R&D, but the smallest unit is units of like, it's usually 4 programmers and 1 QA. Sometimes there might be a dedicated front-end engineer, sometimes there might be a dedicated designer on that team, but for the most part, it's 4 or 5 engineers and 1 QA. The company that moves fast trusts the team of 5 to make the right decisions without any other guidance, without architects, we're approving plans without DBAs, you know, telling them what to do, without the CTO getting involved. It turns out the key is allowing the small team to move fast on its own. So, why do you need that? How do you get to that point? It's that you have to trust every team member. You have to, first of all, everyone will tell you this, hire great people. And when I mean great, it's people who you can give the requirements to and trust that they'll get it right. That doesn't necessarily mean they have to be super senior experienced engineers. You need some of those people, but you need people working with those experienced engineers who will ask questions, get the right answer, people who you can say, here are the requirements, and if they don't know how to do it, they'll find the help they need amongst their teammates. It's about finding people you trust and getting out of their way and letting them do their jobs. I love these little two by twos here. So the construction company, where we do it right, where we're agile, is up in the upper right quadrant up there. Potential for great, whole system success. And it turns out that whole system success is by letting individual teams do the work. At the financial company, it was dysfunctional but successful. And I that's actually correct. This is from a blog post by a lady named Marilyn Aldridge-Spieber, and she works for New Relic, and it's a great blog post, but dysfunctional but probably successful describes the financial company, because it was commercially a success, but is dysfunctional because honestly, people didn't like working there. I didn't like working there. It's one of the reasons I left. So, what practices encourage this autonomy and trust? Well, when you're over a million lines of code, how do you do that? How do you, that's sort of the conundrum here is, you've got a giant web app with a million lines of code. Everyone is working on the same web app. 80 people, you know, 50 devs and a bunch of QAs are working on the same app, and somehow you have to give them autonomy. How do you do that? For number one, always start with the simplest code that works. Don't over-engineer and don't build things you don't need yet. I know you've probably all heard this advice. Trust me, the bigger you are, the more important it becomes. So if you have a feature, so in software like this, we have some very complicated things we do, some things involving OCR and machine learning and things, but most of it is not that. There's a lot of basic CRUD, and there's a lot of, quick submit this form, do some simple business logic, insert some stuff in the database. You should have a system set up in place where you can do that with basic Rails, MVC, and nothing else, and not a lot of added other things. It's a smell, it's a code smell in your huge application. If you ask someone to do something simple, and they have to add a lot of other class design or layers of things on top. Sometimes you need extra layers, and sometimes you need architecture. The mistake is requiring people to use bigger architectures than that when it's not necessary. So allow your devs multiple paths, a simple path to get something out fast, and more complex paths, right, with more complex architectures and reusable pieces where it's needed and only where it's needed, and start with the simple version. And so what about the process, right? That was about code. What about process? Use simple tools. Keep your source control simple. We have this giant organization of 50 people, and we use Gitflow, meaning we have a master branch, we have feature branches, and when you're ready to merge, you do a pull request from your feature branch into master branches. We have no forks. We don't do any rebasing for the most part. And guess what? It turns out we don't need any of that stuff. If I had to give you advice on process, it would be very skeptical of people who tell you that you need something more complex. Make them prove it first. So really your inclination should be to remove things, not add them. Honestly, we use Jira and I hate it because we don't use half the features and I wish we were on Pivotal. Really, that's kind of crazy. I really believe that the bigger company you are and the more people you work on, the simpler your tools should be. So preserve team autonomy, and this is where I think a lot of companies fail. This is definitely where the financial company I worked for failed. And let's start with class design. If you're an architect like me, you might naturally want to give people recipes for class design and hope that the whole department follows it, and that's a mistake. I really believe that every team, every small team, should be able to do things their own way in the same app. There's some trade-offs there. I'm going to come back to this one because this one's important. I'm going to move on and come back to class design because I think it's interesting. Testing, right? There are a lot of ways to test. There are a lot of ways to do automated testing. Some people like to do, full-on behavioral tests using Selenium and Capybara. Some people prefer to do unit tests. Some people do both. And some people pick some strange mashup in the middle where they're testing three or four classes at a time, sort of without really a system. And the right answer, I think, is to let people decide at the team level what they want to do. In other words, there's always someone at the organization who wants to say, okay, we should have 100% unit test coverage and every route should have a controller test, and I say, let the team decide. If you want to do that on your team, then go ahead and do it. And trust your teammates. We talked about trust. Trust your teammates to do it their way if that's not their way of doing it. And this kind of stuff. How and when do you do code review? Do you code review before or after you test? Where do you do your estimates? How do you do your estimates? Do you do the whole burn down charts and the points? Do you even estimate at all? Do you do no estimates? Do you do estimates but not really care about the answer? That's what I like to do. How do you do your meetings and your stand-up? Let it differ team by team. When you start making all teams try to act the same, what you do is you take away the autonomy people. And for one thing, there's a psychological factor. People love to have ownership over their own process, over what they do. They like to be able to decide, you know, within a team level about how they start their day, when they start their day, and let them have that luxury. Because once you start saying, once you've got, you know, 10 teams like we do, and you start telling them all they need to do the same thing, they might resent it, and they might have reasons that you don't understand for wanting to do it that way, so it's best to give them the autonomy to choose their own. We even had for a while, it was like 9 of our teams were on Jira, and one of them was on Basecamp. And eventually they changed, but we let them do that for a while. I'll use a different tool, because you know what? It's better to give people what they want than to be foolishly consistent and worry about, you know, the problems that might cause, because usually the problems are overstated. Specialize late. So here's what I mean by that, is when you're a small company, you want to hire full stack developers. When you're a medium company, you really still want to hire full stack developers. Even when you get large, to be large, you kind of want full stack developers. And I cannot overstate the value of letting people who start as Rails developers also learn and work their way into JavaScript, or also learn and work their way into SQL, or into DevOps, or even switch teams and go to mobile, and things like that. It turns out that by within reason, you can't just let anyone do anything they want all the time, but encourage everyone to be full stack and try to do everything. We didn't start hiring specialists, front-end engineers and DevOps specialists, until we had, I think, 35 devs. So prioritize training, technical and business. When you have an app that huge, it's really easy for a single change to have a ripple effect. And you change one thing and it ruins business logic elsewhere, and somewhere else the calculation doesn't add up. And a project manager is not going to catch that. A QA will catch it, an engineer will catch it, but only if they really understand your business and really understand what you're doing. At Procore, we build construction software, and you'd be surprised, we have dozens of 25-year-old engineers straight out of school who know about more about construction than people who've been in it in their whole lives. And how do we do that? Through intense training. We bring in professors from universities that teach construction management. We bring in industry events. We send our engineers to job sites, and they put on hard hats and walk around construction buildings with the Procore iPad app. We turn engineers into experts because it takes someone who's really, really close to the code to actually know if it's right or not. QA is intensely valuable. I have a friend who works at a different company whose name I won't name, and they have a really insane automated test suite. And it's handcuffs. It stops them from doing what they want to do. Love and value your QAs, make them a valuable part of the team. Often we have team autonomy, so we let people decide, but in some teams, the QAs lead the standing meetings and things like that. So they're, and they should understand the business well too, and give them a kiss because they're your best friends, right? But be real, real skeptical of like heavy, heavy over-automated tooling, because the tooling that's supposed to help oftentimes can become your worst enemy if it doesn't let you get software out, right? So be careful with that. Do it slowly, do it incrementally, and make sure you're solving a real problem when you start to automate QA. Let people choose their own work. I mentioned that, but you know, our whole history as an organization, you see people jumping from web to mobile, from mobile to JavaScript. Encourage that. There's some realistic limits. You can't just let everyone jump teams whenever they want, but encourage team switching, you know. You'll end up with better, more rounded engineers. Internal open source, this is awesome. So as you'd imagine, in an application like ours, we have like a team that's an infrastructure team that does sort of like the wide like app architecture and the cross-cutting thing. So like permission touches every tool. You know, permission is cross-cutting, security and things like that. So we have a team that works on that. And as you can imagine, if I'm in a different team, say I'm in the team that does financials, sometimes I need to add things to the framework, I need to add things to the app, which is usually the domain of the infrastructure team. But what we do is something called internal open source. What it means is I'm allowed to contribute to the infrastructure. I open a pull request and they code review it, right? So it's just like an open source where you can contribute to a third party package. We do that internally where anyone from any team contributes to the infrastructure part, to sort of the core application functionality. And that's a wonderful model. I absolutely love it. On the technical end, I'm going to make a few presumptions here because this is not like one size fits all. Depending on what you're doing and what your company does, you know, you may be doing something different, but I'm making some presumptions. One is that we're moving fast in a competitive industry. We've got people trying to eat our lunch. We're trying to win. It's a dog-eat-dog world. We want to ship fast, make our customers happy, and steal customers from our competitors. It's feature-heavy software. We're growing teams. We're hiring both experts and beginners, so we have to worry about onboarding, right? We have to worry about junior devs, people fresh out of school, as well as senior engineers, all getting up to speed and working fast. So working with these presumptions, here are my recommendations if you need to be successful with a giant web app with a million lines of code. Actually, here's what not to do. Actually, I take it back. This is not what not to do. Here's some things that people have always told me to do that I find that are overrated, where people will give you this advice, and I don't think it pays off. Number one, architectural consistency. Here's what I mean. I told you I used to work at a smaller company that sold shoes online, right? And we had very specific patterns. We had an interface called MVC, and then we had an adapter, and then we had a service, and then we had a data access object. And those had well-defined interfaces. These are methods that every service object had a method called exec, right? One public method, and we had very well-defined architectural patterns. Turns out, even within an app, you might be better off not making your teams all follow the same architectural recipes. We take class design very, very seriously. In fact, has anyone ever read Principles of Object-Oriented Design by Sandy Metz? Yeah, we have Sandy Metz come into our office and teach a class, a three-day class for every single engineer. She teaches it three times so that everyone can go through it every year. We take that very seriously, but even with that, you still have people who interpret those rules differently. Not everyone does it exactly her style. We've got some people who came from the Java world and tend to use Gang of Four style patterns, you know, where they're making, you know, factory classes and command classes and things like that. And then some people like layers, you know, like between every controller and every model, there's one service layer if it reads, one command layer if it writes. Those are different styles, and we let the teams do different styles within the same app. That has some drawbacks, right? Because we have some inconsistencies in design. Not everyone's using the same architecture. And the drawback of that is, like, say I go from one team to the other, I have to readjust my sort of view of the way applications work, right? I might change to a different style of class design, which also necessitates sometimes a different style of testing. So there's overhead there, right? That slows us down. I think that it's worth it. I think in the order of giving people the autonomy to do their own thing and to design apps the way they like, it is okay to let people do different styles of class design and different styles of application architecture within a single app.
Yikes. Wow, I talked so long and fell asleep.
And just a few things that I can tell you about this, and these are real, real simple, right, at Rails. I mean, I can pretty much boil down all the advice I can give to you about class design and Rails into a few simple things. Keep the business logic and the queries out of the views. Keep your views dumb, right? Try to isolate the business logic away from the database queries. How you do that is up to you. It's about the best advice I can give you because everything else kind of depends on what you're doing. Don't be tempted to try every single gem, right? Small gems are okay. Little gems you can manage. Little gems that do one thing well. We have hundreds of them in our gem files. Be really wary of big gems because your gems, it's like your children, right? You only have as many as you can take care of because you're in for the long haul here and you're going to be working on this project for years. And there's a long history in Ruby of people making big gems that do a lot of things and then dropping development or just stopping, and all of a sudden you're stuck with this dependency, you know, that's either getting out of date, that possibly has security holes, or you just decide it was a bad decision to begin with. So be extra cautious about gems. Use small gems. Don't use a lot of huge gems. I think code coverage is tremendously overrated. I think this is a pointless metric. Like I said, I trust people when they... I trust my teammates when I ask, is this code tested? Are you sure it works? Are the tests in place? Yes, I trust you. I don't need to see some metric that says you have 100% code coverage. I don't believe in 100% code coverage. Some of us do on my team, and that's also okay. Some of us don't test at all. We try to change their mind, but if that's their prerogative, and it gets through QA, and they assure me it works, it can be hard sometimes, but I trust them. Modularity is interesting. So when we talk about class design and software architecture, you typically think of a few things. Like, what do you try to accomplish with your class design? You want performance, security, extensibility, testability, maintainability, and inevitably you always see this one, modularity. Modularity means the ability to isolate code, usually in a class, so that it can be reused somewhere else. Guess what? Most of the time, you architect for modularity, you don't need it, you don't use it. This is the cause, in my opinion, this is probably the most controversial part of my talk. The desire to do class design for modularity is probably the most overrated thing, probably the cause of the most over-engineering in software. Because you always see this lumped in as an architectural prerogative, modularity. And sometimes it gets really crazy. Have you ever heard anyone tell you, oh yeah, put your things in classes so that if you need to take it out of Rails and put it in Sinatra, you can? Bullshit, right? If you think about that, you are thinking for the wrong thing. Or I love, yeah, take your, you know, do your logic this way and design your classes this way, so if you need to swap out Postgres for MongoDB, you can. No, you are making your life difficult and your customers are waiting and they're mad because you're not shipping when you're doing stuff like that. Dry is good, but don't be a foolish slave to dry, honestly. If you looked into our code base, I'm a little ashamed to admit it, you'd probably find five or six different places where we've implemented how to validate a phone number. You know what I mean? Because it was here somewhere and someone else didn't know it was there and did it again. Guess what? It's not the end of the world. That's not an excuse to be lazy. You want to try to reuse logic, but don't create elaborate, like if you see like two lines of code and they're the same and you're tempted to do some elaborate refactoring and some, you know, extract some abstraction just to get rid of one copy and pasted lines of code or a couple of copy and pasted lines of code, it might not be worth it. In fact, don't be dry just for dry's sake. You want to be mostly dry, but you don't need to be 100%. Sometimes the copy-paste example is actually better. So where's the good? Where do we focus? I'll go through these quickly. Testing. Make sure people test, but don't get too obsessed about how they test. You want it to be tested, but it's not the style of test that matters. It's that at least someone did their homework and wrote tests and could tell you it works. Background processing, right? This is fantastic. Do you ever use Sidekick? Get early in the game, make it real easy, design your app so that things that what we see all the time is you've got this request, it hits this controller, oh, it's too slow, we need to move it to a background job. Get good at that, get the infrastructure in place, get Sidekick set up, it's awesome. Database design. Some errors are easy to fix, like JavaScript errors and Rails errors. Some of these can be hard, right? If there's worth time, if you're gonna spend time trying to get things right the first time, try to get it on your schema design. That doesn't mean try to anticipate things that you don't need yet, but at least for the thing you're working on, try to get that right. Feature flags are awesome. This is kick-ass. If you're developing fast, you need the ability to hide and show certain features. Invest in this. It's worth the time. Deployment, you have to be able to deploy fast. Deployment should be painless. We do it in Slack. If I write new code, three people code review it, they hit merge, I can deploy with a single Slack command. It's worth time investing in this. I'm going to skip this because I don't have time. Front-end frameworks. Be careful, be real careful, because these can make everyone's lives difficult. It can make hiring difficult. You can end up picking the wrong one. If you 2 years ago picked up Angular, guess what? You're not cool anymore because people are on React. I would advise you, if you're on a big app, to make it possible, if you're using a heavy front-end framework, to also make it possible to not use it, right? To have options to either use it or not use it. I recommend that because you can knock things out faster, come back, add the front-end framework later. And then, I'm going to skip some of this because I'm out of time. In the end, the key to success is not about choosing the right technology or ORMs, your testing style. It's making people pride and ownership in what they do. Make sure every single person in your department feels like their contributions are valued, that you're providing an environment they can grow and become better engineers and better people. Keep them close to the business so they hear the customers. Choose processes that encourage ownership. When in doubt, remove processes. Take away obstacles. Don't add them. Don't be afraid to experiment. Remove barriers that make it easier to experiment. Don't let perfect be the enemy of shipped. Hire great people and trust them. Remember what I told you about the financial company when they released every 6 months, how their customers hated it? It turns out if you follow these rules, customers see that your changes are coming fast and they see that you're responding to changes. When you knock out features in a day instead of 6 months, all of a sudden your customers stop fearing change. All of a sudden the customers are your friend, and all of a sudden they can't wait to see what you do next, and then they're customers for life. And that's how you win the game. Questions? No questions, go on. Okay, go.
Okay, so you say, I think I need a microphone.
Yeah,
microphone versus just shouting in front of the audience is probably a good idea. So you said avoid frameworks for your front end. So what is your go-to strategy?
I said be careful about frameworks.
How are you careful about frameworks?
So we have a really awesome React stack. We have it's really slick. It's Webpack. It's React. It's Babel. It took way too long to put it together, but now that we have it, it's pretty dang cool. But we rolled it out slowly. So my advice would be make it possible to build your app without it and make it optional, not required. That's the main thing. And remember, we're not talking about do one thing well type of companies. If you're a do one thing well type of companies, it might be worth like a 100% React front end or something like that. I'm talking a little bit more about enterprise software with thousands of features. I would be really hesitant. I would have a good framework for where you need it, for you need that stuff, but I would be really hesitant to make it a necessity to use it for every feature. Because it really will slow you down, it really slows down onboarding, it makes it hard to hire if you're on the wrong one, right? So in other words, have it, but make it optional for most pieces.
That sounds good.
Yeah.
Do you have any more questions for the audience? We can one more.
Right here.
Oh. Just behind you.
So you said that to let the teams decide what standards and what design patterns to consider. So how do you maintain a coding standard across the entire organization? Like, what efforts do you take to make sure that each team has that level of coding standards or programming standards?
Well, the point is that we don't really have a lot of standards. I mean, we have a hound which runs RubuCop and gives us some style guidelines. It's a pretty minimal set, right? I don't believe in bothering people with syntax. We talk about more like syntax or like class design?
Class design. Maybe.
Like class design. Well, the point is we don't enforce it. Each team does it their own. So we have teams that do just 100% straight MVC. We have teams that do like MVC, but like between the controller and the model, they have a service or a command. We have teams that do Java style Gang of Four. We have teams that do Sandy Metz sort of like domain modeling. And they're all different, and they're all in the same app. And there's some drawbacks, but guess what? The drawbacks aren't that bad. It's not a big deal. If I have to switch teams and see someone else's code, sometimes I have to readjust. But what you gain out of that in just speed and giving people ownership and letting people architect on their own and involving as few people as possible, you know, that are needed in order to do a single feature is worth, I think, the consistency that you give up. Yes.
Thank you for your talk, very interesting. I think the autonomous you give to the team is very interesting in terms of diversity you can get, like you say, for the writing style and the choice you can do. How do you, in terms of communication, what kind of communication tools or way of communicating between the team to make sure that people, because I guess they spend a lot of time within the team, but to make sure that they know also other teams and what's happening in the company.
Good question. Inside engineering is completely informal. We have Slack, and we have a lot of topic-devoted Slack rooms. So migrations are always tough. We're serving 20 million rows from our database, and we have to change the database while people are using it. So we have a special channel, a Slack channel, just for that, right? We have a special channel just for people who need help with React. We have a special Slack channel just for people who have SQL questions. So it's informal. The company has updates and things, but the engineering, from the business people, we get updates about the quarter and things like that. But the engineering team, we have a weekly Friday meeting that everyone is supposed to tune into, but over half the time we just cancel it. You know? In other words, people just gotta self-organize. If you need help from another team, you know, ask them, make an appointment, find a meeting room, or just ping them on Slack. I think the sort of natural, organic way of just encouraging people to mingle, talk to each other, meet, you know, work over Slack, beats organized meeting schedule anything. And I mean that, I don't see much of a drawback to that, even.
Great, that's all we have time for, Brett. Well, thank you very much for sharing, and let's take a 3-minute break, and our section will start in 3 minutes. Let's give a round of applause for Brett.